This podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
Okay, so I'm going to continue from where we left off this morning, where I just written the two-loop, four-point, n equals four, Subriang-Mills loop level integrand on the blackboard. And what I'm going to discuss are graph methods for cut verification. So the problem is somebody hands you some expression, integrand level, maybe it's graph organized, and the question is it appropriate scattering amplitude for the theory under consideration? That's a good question, right? So let's say you write down an integrand. How do you know it's right? Okay, and there's a solution, as I mentioned this morning. The solution is to show that it satisfies all dimensional unitarity cuts. Okay. Turns out that it's actually, in fact, it's sufficient to show that it satisfies cuts down to tree level. Cuts to tree level are sufficient to show that it spans all cuts. In fact, I'll discuss more generally how there are spannings, the notion of spanning sets of cuts, such that if you satisfy those cuts, then you're guaranteed to satisfy all cuts. All right. First things first. It's a tree level cut. Some sum over states, internal states, of a product of trees. Okay, so these are full color dress trees. For Young-Mills theory, then it would be a color dress cut. Also, fine gauge invariant quantity to consider are color stripped cuts. Otherwise known as color ordered cuts. Or states. Instead of our calligraphic A's or curly A's, we'll have our nice friendly Roman A's that's just kinematics. So this guy's would have colors. This would have group theory like color factors. Okay, thing to note, all exposed momenta on shell. Okay, so quick aside, what cuts are relevant to M particle a loop? All right, or otherwise, how do you find a good L loop M particle cut? to consider if you want to verify that your expression satisfies it. First, consider vertex rep of any L loop M particle graph of any valence greater than 2. So valence, the number of edges that come on. So I'm not restricting myself to cubic graphs here, right? So any number of edges coming into vertices. Turn necklaces into trees. So not just three guys in a necklace, however many, goes to A. Take product of trees. In some of our internal states. Okay, so somebody give me a loop number. How many loops? Bigger than two. Three. All right. Good. Cool. Well, whatever. So the easiest one to, of course, consider off the top is the L plus one particle cut gives you three loops. So it is at 4.1234. Here's my diagrammatic representation of the graph. I'll turn it into a vertex representation in a second. L1, L2, L3, L4. Okay. K1, K2, L3, L2, L1. Negative L1, negative L2, negative L3, negative L4. K3, K4. If this was a color-ordered cut, then my being careful to actually match this makes sense. If it doesn't, then we don't care, of course. And what I say we do, just turn it into a tree. And we sum over the states of all the internal lines. Okay? So here we go. So this is how to find a L loop M particle cut. Now the problem at hand, the methods I'm going to talk about right now this afternoon is the problem of cut verification. Where should I go? Extracting an expression from integrand to compare with a cut. And presumably to demonstrate equivalence. Right, then when you actually evaluate that, you stick in numbers, and you stick in numbers to the expression you evaluated from this, you get the same answer. They're the same. You don't have to stick in numbers if you fail to show analytically they're the same. You can stick in numbers. Okay, so how do we do this? Well, it turns out if you've organized your integrand graphically, then it's actually fairly straightforward, and that's what I'm going to talk about. All right, first bit is going to be identifying by contributing topologies. So what topologies from your L loop graph, your L loop amplitude contribute to a cut expression. So just the same way that tree level amplitudes, color dressed, color ordered, or gravity amplitudes, what have you, are the building blocks cuts. Turns out tree graphs will be the building blocks of our topologies. Instance, I want you guys to all be able to go home and do whatever loop order you want at the end of this. We're going to take a little bit of time to make sure we know how to write down all the trees we'd ever need to write down. Okay, so this goes under the heading of gross motor skills. This is just the type of stuff we need to be able to do. Building ordered tree graphs. Okay. Okay. I'm going to call S N the set of ordered tree graphs with n, so it's going to have n external legs. And all the external legs are going to be in order in some very meaningful sense. 1, 2, 3, dot, 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 dot. And then you'll be able to define a handedness to your graph and trace an order all the way through. All right, what's an algorithm for building these guys? For all g in this ordered n, for all edges in g, between and including edge n and edge 1. Add a graph to Sn plus 1 with leg and plus one attached to edge E in the correct order. Okay, so for this particular graph, how many choices of location do I have to add n plus one? Okay, but I want to do it such that it's between n, edge n, and between edge 1, including n and including 1. In the correct order. So I could add it here, n plus 1, and to the right of n and to the left of 1, in my whatever odd definition of rightedness, I could have added it here, could have added it here, and I could have added it here. Okay? Let me start. Let me actually, it's worth taking a second to make sure I'm being clear with this. Okay. Start with the cubic graph. 1, 2, that's not a 2. That's a 2, that's a 3, and that's in order, okay? Where are the two places I can add 4? I can add a 4 here, pointing this way, and a 4 here, pointing this way. Okay? That leads me to 1, 2, 3, 4, right? It also leads me to 1, 4, 2, 3. Yes? Okay. Now, for this guy, how many places can I add 5 for this graph? 3 places, right? Here, here, and here. For this graph, how many can I add 5? 2, good. So for my 5 point, there will be 5 color orders, five ordered graphs for my 5 point ordered tree. So on and so forth. Okay, so that's, so this is the algorithm for color ordered graphs. Now, for unordered, the algorithm's even easier. Oh, wait a second. Wait. All right. Now, I was going to be a little bit more formal just for a second. All right, so this is my more formal, slightly more formal discussion on this. Can define right rightness on a tree graph such that external leg on a ordered, that's the external leg 1 is the external leg directly the right of leg n of a ordered n point tree. Okay. Okay, one way to do this, concatenate the necklaces, right? Concatenate the necklaces of the nodes and track the order of the external edges. Okay, so we can introduce an inverse soft limit operator. It's a little tongue-in-cheek name for an operator such that I operate it on S ordered of n, and I get S ordered of n plus 1. Okay, so S n equals my inverse operator raised to the n minus 3 on S, well, on 1, 2, 3. Okay, so suggested exercise algorithm for implementing this operator on vertex representations. Okay, it's one exercise. Actually, another exercise, which is also interesting to think about. Here, I'm gonna go to a new board just so I can write it fully. In case this wasn't obvious by context, cubic. So what I'm talking about here have all been cubic graphs, and that's what this algorithm was. Okay? Ordered cubic graphs. Okay, another exercise. Consider G, I, J, graph, old, new. Okay. It's this set of graphs. Identical to G. External leg new, the new external leg attached to external leg old, such that new is to the right of I and the left of J, of external edge I and the left of external edge J. So the question is, what's the max size of this set for trees? Does this change for loops? Everything here I was talking about, of course, was for trees, but this you can define for loops as well. So it's a good exercise to think about that. All right. Are there any questions? So if you want to do color-ordered cuts, you've got to be able to draw color-ordered tree graphs. So this is good business. So I can take a second if people want to think about this. Oh, here, let me put this up. Non-ordered, cubic tree construction. Simpler algorithm. Yeah, this is actually much simpler. For all G and S unordered, for all edges in G, add
to S unordered M plus 1. With servile edge n plus 1 attached t. Okay, so now there are going to be more of these guys, right, than these guys. All right, so how many of these guys are there going to be? N leg cubic graph. Has N external edges and N minus 3 internal edges. Draw this clear way, you guys can count if you want. Okay. So the size of n plus 1 is going to be. So what is this? So 2n minus 3 edges, right? Good. So it's going to be 2n minus 3 times the size 1 ordered n. 2n minus 3 times 2n minus 5 times a set of 1 ordered n minus 1. Equals minus 3, n minus 5, 2n minus 7, dot 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 3. Equals 2, 2n minus 5, double factorial. So you could end up drawing a lot of graphs. Okay, sorry. So this is the set of unordered graphs with n point external edges, with n external edges.
Yeah, but when you start adding.
Okay, good. Let me. How about I go through it? Yeah. Okay.
No. I understand a little bit. I mean, when you start adding edges, then you should change the index to.
Yeah. I'm sorry. Did I not?
No, I mean, you have Sn of n, or when you're removing edges, you should change the index of Sn or not?
I think the right hand side is the number of elements in Sn as an offset of n plus minus 1 in the formula.
You have two indexes, the one in between brackets and then this.
Okay, let's see what I do. Okay, so. Yeah, this isn't an index. This is a U. I'm just saying this is an unordered set. I'm sorry. Excuse my handwriting. In fact, it does look a lot like an N. Sorry. Oh, no, that was an N. No wonder it looked like an N. Okay, but no, this was definitely supposed to be a U. And this was a U, and that was a U. Yes. Yeah, sorry, yes, sorry, good. Okay. Yes, sorry, I got carried away. 2n minus 3 factorial, and then of course, if this is this, then SU, thank you, n equals 2n minus 5 double factorial. Very good, thank you. Okay. By two, it's going down by two. That's right. Somehow I made it all the way to calculating graviton tree level scattering amplitudes before I learned the notation. So, yeah. Okay, so just this is kind of an obvious exercise, but come up with an algorithm for implementing the unordered inverse soft limit. Okay. As a side, can ask what's the number of distinct ordered cubic endpoint tree graphs. And the answer, Catalan number, 2^(n-2) to n-5 double factorial. N-1 factorial. Now, we can actually see it by looking at the algorithm, but there's actually another kind of very nice way of seeing why this is the answer. Okay, and one way to solve a problem is to map it to an ancient solved problem. Turns out this is 1-to-1 with the number of distinct ways of cutting an convex polygon into n-2 triangles with non-intersecting lines. This is Euler's famous polygon division problem. And the way to see this, to see that this is true, if this isn't obvious to everyone already, is to recall that all tree graphs are planar. And all tree graphs are planar. Okay, so here's a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 point tree graph. Or if it's planar, I can define a dual space where I take all my vertices and map them to loops, and I take all my loops and map them to vertices. You say, where are my loops? Well, my loops are the fact that these guys all meet at infinity on the other side of my sphere, and so I will define this to be a vertex, 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 and this to be a vertex in the dual space. I will cross all my edges, and we see that we have cut with this one tree graph, this one ordered tree graph, we have cut the hexagon into one of its unique slices into triangles. And so a little work and you can convince yourself these are actually 1-to-1 problems. In fact, this was used when we were calculating 5 loops planar a number of years ago as just one way of generating all the dual graphs that would go in. Since it's easier to do planar calculations than n equals 4,
in dual variables. Okay. Okay, so anything, any questions about building trees? Enough of our gross motor skills. Okay, identifying. All right. First thing, consider the set of trees. Contributing to the cut. Replace each tree. With the set. Graphs contributing to that tree with appropriate labels. So tree labels L1 to LN gets mapped to SO. Oh, this is a color ordered tree, SON. So in order to be SON, with simply each I going to whatever the ith label was in here. As an example, four-point tree with external labels labeled A, B, C, D goes to A, B, C, D, and A, B, C, D. Okay? I'll do a five-point example. So, consider the cut. So this is a two-loop cut, so relevant for poking at our two-loop guy from above. So where it states A, K1, K2, L3, L2, L1, A, negative L1, negative L2, L3, K3, K4. Okay, so we're sewing together two five-particle trees. Put this all the way up there.
together. Biparticle trees. Where do I want to draw? I guess I want to draw my trees over here. Okay, good. So here are my 5-point color ordered trees, right? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to replace the labels on those guys with the labels on those guys as necessary. Labels and 5 graphs. With those labels. Does anybody want to see me replace labels? Is everybody confident they can see how to replace labels themselves? I have no problem replacing labels for you, but I think you get the picture, right? I'll do one example. Okay, one. K2, L3, L2, L1. 4 other guys. Right? Yes? Okay, good. All right, now we get to the fun bit. Okay, now we get to see loop-level topologies. How do we get loop-level topologies? We get it by sewing tree graphs. Identify multi-loop contribution. You take a generalized outer product between all the sets of graphs that would be contributing to your cut. So this was a cut involving sewing together 2 trees. You can have cuts sewing together 5 trees, 15 trees, however many trees you want. You can consider, for example, I'm sure somebody must have mentioned maximal cuts by now, where you cut all available propagators. Has somebody mentioned maximal cuts? Yeah? Has one of my colleagues mentioned maximal cuts yet? Okay. Well, you're going to see people call them, well, you'll see lots of, okay, anyway. So this would be sewing together a number of 3-point graphs. In any case, you can sew together any number of graphs. What we're going to do is we're going to take a generalized outer product between graphs, and the product is going to involve sewing the tree graphs. So what is sewing? All right.
radically. One just attaches outgoing cut momenta with incoming cut momenta. Take, well, chosen an example from each of those sets of graphs. K1, K2, L3, L2, 1, outgoing. Minus L1, minus L2, minus L3 outgoing, K4, K3, right? So what do? Is I just attach them. Okay, and I draw a dashed line to indicate that these guys are on shell. Okay, so this is a potentially contributing topology to the cut, right? By taking one of these guys, right, and one of these guys, and so on. And I'm going to do it for all of these guys paired with all of these guys. Okay? They will all be different graphs, but there will be shared topologies, but with different labels and with different cut lines, with different legs off shell. So this guy's off shell, this guy's off shell, and this guy's off shell in this graph, right? Because it's got loop momenta. So sorry, I should have written this. This is still L3 going this way. This is still L2 going this way. This is still L1 going that way, right? These are on shell momenta, right? So these cut lines are all on shell. Okay. Well, that was diagrammatically. Surely things are going to be much, much, much more complicated with our vertex-based graph representation, right? Not at all. It's going to be super simple. All right. Best graph representation. So it's even easier. Okay, that guy, he was. Okay, let me just do it. L3, L2, L3, L2, I'll call it. A1, he was minus A1, minus A2, K2, and he was, well, did he have to be minus, he could have been, oh, minus A2, whatever, I didn't draw arrows. And then this will be A2, L1, K1. Okay, so this is going to be that guy's vertex-based representation. This guy is going to be minus L3, K3, call it B1, minus B1, K4, B2, minus B2, minus L1. Is L2. Okay, and the sewing operation for vertex-based graphs is just to concatenate your lists of nodes. Okay, so the operation is just to erase this division and consider all the set of nodes as the graph. If you notice, this is that cut graph. Ah, okay. Well, why don't I label them? I should have done this on slightly separate. I should have done this over here. Okay, but let me. So I think I had A1 there, and I had A2 there. Right? Well, it's right. I mean, so it's the edge. It's the internal edge that's unspecified that is carrying the momentum. In this case, it's going to be minus K1 plus minus K1 minus L1. That way. Okay. So I mean, right? Each of these edges has momentum, right? Yeah. So but they're completely specified by conservation of momentum. Is this clear? Are there any questions so far? Does somebody want to see me do an example with more than two trees? Or do you think you see how it generalizes? Yeah? Okay, come up to me afterwards if you want to see more than two trees. All right, we're almost done. Almost home. So what do we have? How many graphs do we have on this cut? Twenty-five graphs. Contributing graphs. Good. Now we get to dress them. We get to dress them according to the integrand we're checking, right? So our graph organized representation of our L loop endpoint amplitude. All right. If it's a Yang-Mills theory, what does it have? It has these mappings, numerators going from graphs to some kinematic expression. Right? Also has denominators. And if it's Yang-Mills, it'll have color factors. Okay, and it's defined for all graphs cubic that are L loop and endpoint. Right? Many of these could be zero. The numerator could be zero. In fact, for n equals 4 at 4 point, for 2 loop 4 point, if you remember, I had these two graphs only, right? All other cubic topologies with four external legs and two loops had numerator mappings to zero, right? But it's defined for all cubic graphs. All right, good. So I'm going to call set of contributing topologies, contributing graphs, to cut, annotated T contributing to the cut. Not an inventive name, but it's shorter than writing out sentence. So for all graphs element of T contributing, find isomorphic graph G element L M. Does everybody know what a graph isomorphism is? Graph isomorphism. Anybody not know what a graph isomorphism is? Okay, good. Let's use this as an example. Okay. This graph. Let's forget about the labels for a second, right? It has the same connectivity as this graph, right? I just drew it differently. It's the same graph, right? Same graph. It's not a lot to do with that two-loop ladder, but what I did to make it look confusing, there's not a whole lot you can do. But believe me, there's all sorts of ways of drawing multi-loop and particle graphs that can be confusing when you just look at it. Is this the same graph? But it turns out if they are the same graph, there is a mapping, direct mapping from whatever the equivalent edge is in graph A to graph B. This is sort of an informal definition. Let me see if I can spruce this up a little bit. Question of graph isomorphism, isomorphic. The question between two graphs, GA and GB, is does there exist a mapping one-to-one between edges in graph A and in graph B? Okay, if the answer is yes, right, then the two graphs are isomorphic, and you can map the labels of graph A to the labels of graph B. Okay, there may be ambiguous ways. There may be more than one isomorphism. For example, A, B, C, D. Little A, little B, little C, little D. Okay. What's one isomorphism between this graph and this graph? Just talk about the external legs because I didn't bother labeling the rest. Yeah. Big A to little A. Does anybody see any other mappings? Yeah, right? So you can flip it around like this, right? I can flip it like that. This guy has many automorphisms, right? Same. Okay, it's to itself. Good. All right. So what I was saying over here is, okay, I've got some graph topology as a result of sewing my trees together, but they've got whatever weird labels came into my cut, right? Not necessarily whatever idealized labels are residing in the land of capital gamma 3. Okay, but if I find the graph in here that I've got my numerators defined as, and I find a mapping between, should have called this graph tilde. Yeah, so my cut graph, I have an isomorphic graph here, then I can do the following. Okay. For all graphs in here, find the isomorphic graph G in here, and define N G tilde to be N of G, but relabeled under isomorphism. Okay, so let's see how that works in this case. So, I said the two-loop guy, two-loop planar, was dressed with this universal factor of ST, 1, 2, 3, 4, A tree, this is the color order tree, times a factor of K1 plus K2 squared. Okay? Under any of the isomorphisms between here and here, they'd all be equivalent, A plus B squared. S-A-B, S-A-D, A-A, oh, goodness, A-B-C-D, A-0, right? This is equivalent, of course, to C plus D squared S-C, oh, goodness, C-D, S-C-B, A-naught, C D A B, I guess. All right. So this would be either of these, and they are equal, would be N of graph tilde, where tilde is this cut graph. Okay? What is the denominator of the cut graph? This is just the mapping we described before. It's all the uncut off-shell propagators of P tilde product. Okay, so it's this momentum squared plus this momentum squared, not this, not this, not this, but this momentum squared times this momentum squared. Okay? That's the denominator of this cut graph. Okay. So, cut contribution of graph organize integrand will be for ordered cuts, for color ordered cuts, unordered cuts, or color-dressed cuts,
Now, okay, so let me just continue here. I'm just going to continue with this example for just a second, and then I'm going to address some subtleties that are easy to light over that would but would bite you if you just blindly marched ahead. Okay, so in any case, what is contributing to this guy? A, K1, K2, L3, L2, L1. L1, L2, L3, K4. So it restates. It's going to be K1 plus K2 squared times that universal prefactor, which is permutation independent, divided by the denominator of 1, 2, 3, 4. Plus one more term. K1 plus K4 squared. Denominator. Okay. All other graphs that came out of this planar, so it could vanish, right? This is the only planar contribution at n equals 4. And these are the three times this topology shows up. I encourage you to spend a little time actually drawing graphs yourself and convincing yourself that this is what shows up. And it turns out that if you do this cut, or you look up this cut from the late 90s when it was first done, you will find that this is, in fact, the answer. Universal prefactor. Universal prefactor, this is K1 plus K2, K1 plus K4 squared, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, good. This was a planar cut. If you're going to do color-dressed cuts, then you don't have to worry about this stuff because you're going to be dealing with ordered graphs and FABCs. But something that can happen when you're doing non-planar cuts is you will have defined a numerator for a graph in a particular color ordering, even a planar guy, right? So the numerator of this, we said, was positive K1 plus K2 squared, the universal prefactor. Okay, but what if the graph you come up with after sewing your trees together has one vertex with a contra ordering, right? You have to dress this guy with the minus of the guy that was isomorphic to. In a sense, I mean, this is just a bit of bookkeeping. You could imagine recording the numerators with all odd number of vertex flips, just with the minus signs, and then you'd never have to worry about it as long as you were tracking ordering. Or you could just remember to multiply the signatures of your orders relative to whatever your canonical graphs were in your representation. Okay. All right, so this was all about how to verify one cut. The example I did was a color ordered cut. And I should spend a second saying what would be different for a color dressed cut. Color dressed cuts right. What's going to be in here, the expressions that are going to come out are going to have color factors, products of FABCs, times kinematics. Right? So what you're going to stick into here are going to be trees dressed with FABCs. Right? So you're going to stick in the trees and I. Okay, so associated with this are going to be graphs, right? In a sense, unordered graphs, but you're going to attach them with FABCs. Maybe I should, I don't have time to work out an exercise. I can either prepare an exercise to discuss at another time, you guys can approach me later, or I'll just include this in the notes I'm typing up, some examples. Okay? All right, because what I haven't, so I've told you how to verify a cut, but I haven't told you how to verify all cuts associated with an L-loop amplitude, and I'd like to do that, and that means talking about spending sets. Spanning set of cuts is any cut, any set of cuts, whose satisfaction guarantees that all cuts will be satisfied. All right, in order to do this, must touch all the graph topologies. Is in always that saturate potential power counting. Okay, what does this mean? So you see these graphs here? These are cut edges, right? For n equals 4, there's no loop momentum dependence at two loops. But when I look at a cut graph, the numerator of a cut graph, this guy at three loops, definitely has loop momentum dependence, okay? And if I cut the loop momenta, let's say I do a cut like this, for example. Well, this is not such a great example. Let's go to five loops. This is a fantastic example. All right. So I go to five loops. If I consider this cut, I'll cut a bunch of lines. All right. I'm going to pick up some of the kinematic contributions, but I'll miss any kinematics proportional to, if this guy was called L, any proportion, any guy's proportional to L squared, right? I won't see him on this cut. All right. So every cut explores only up to given factors of loop momenta. Now theories, all theories have some UV behavior, right? And you need to at least saturate the UV behavior with the cuts you're considering, the expected UV behavior with the cuts you're considering, such that based upon, so you're allowed to cheat in your head and realize that you've got Feynman rules that are dressing, underlying all this stuff, right? And at most, they could only contribute so much loop momenta in anything sitting in a numerator, right? As long as you allow, you release sufficient cut conditions to show more than that amount of loop momenta in the numerator, then you've guaranteed there are no spots where Feynman diagram contributions could be hiding. Let me try to do this with pictures. Find a spanning set. Consider all cubic graphs. Okay. You take the maximal cuts of every graph. So you write down all your cubic graphs. So this is 3 loops, 4 point. I mean, there are more graphs. Okay. And I consider the maximal cut of these guys. This is not a spanning set of cuts. Why? Because I'm missing loop momenta contributions, right? This guy has loop momenta. This guy has loop momenta contributions in the numerator. This doesn't. All right? So I start releasing cut conditions. I consider all graphs where for each of these edges, I consider all the cuts where I put one of them on shell. So it'll be this guy on shell or this guy on shell. So, and I do this for all these guys. I take the union of these topologies, of these cuts. So this is now a tree. This is now a tree. So it's a 4-point tree and a 4-point tree and so on. Does this saturate the potential bad power counting? Turns out for n equals 4, it does. For n equals 8, it might not have based upon naive looking at gravity Feynman rules. In fact, you need to collapse more propagators. You need to consider all the cuts that had two collapsed propagators, or at least two off-shell internal vertices. But that was enough to guarantee that you wouldn't be missing any contributions from Feynman rules. But that's still a lot of cuts to do to verify, and you can do a lot better than that by continuing to release cut conditions until, so you start with maximal cuts, and you start releasing cut conditions, and you release all the cut conditions until you have this small set of graphs such that releasing one more cut condition would introduce an off-shell loop. So what's an example of that? Okay, we saw one at two loops, so this is a cut, right? If I tried to release this, well, okay, this is, so L plus one particle cuts, I can't reduce anymore. Let's talk about this guy. So here's another cut. Right, it's an iterated two-particle cut of two loops. If I tried to release this cut condition, it's still cut here, I'm okay. But if I try to release this cut condition, right, I've introduced a loop. Okay, so I don't need to. In fact, I'm even if I release this guy, I'm introducing sort of a self-sewn term. So in essence, I'm introducing a loop here. So the set of sufficient minimal spanning set at two loops would be basically iterated two particle cut and the three particle cut. This way oversaturates the power counting of n equals 4 because n equals 4 has no loop momentum in the numerators. But still, this guarantees that you're missing no cut contributions at two loops. Okay, so I feel like I'm running out of time. I'm going to stop here and open the floor for questions.
Sorry, you were covering the picture while you were talking. I didn't understand anything.
Okay.
Make it bigger.
Yeah. All right, how about I just give a recipe? All right, consider all graphs, right? Start with all internal edges on shell. Start releasing on shell conditions. Graph by graph. Terminate when next off shell introduction would introduce a loop. This turns out to be an incredibly small number of cuts you end up needing to check at any loop order. And this doesn't depend on power counting. So this would be the algorithm to find what's called a minimal of cuts, right? The cuts necessary to verify that that your integrand representation contains all the information of the scattering amplitude.
Maybe an example of one loop would be more easy.
Okay, good. So at one loop, all right, so you could start by cutting all these guys, right? The box cut, quadra cut, yeah. But I can release this cut condition, yes? Okay, or I could have
released this cut condition, kept these guys cut, right, so on and so forth. It turns out I can also release this cut condition, right? Or I could, for that guy, have released, kept this cut, released these cuts. So sewing two trees, okay? So I've got this sewing of a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 tree to a 3-point vertex, right? Which would necessitate continuing on complex momenta running around. Or I've got this nice real cut, right, with a 4-tree and a 4-tree. Now, ask me if I can release this cut condition. Well, if I release this cut condition right here, then I'm pretty much doing a one-particle cut, or an L-particle cut, sewing a tree to itself, right, which is equivalent to actually introducing sort of a loop, an off-shell loop. So I don't need to do that. And in fact, considering the two particle cuts is sufficient for to capture the behavior. Two particle cuts and d dimensions is sufficient to capture the behavior. I'm considering massive theories that I can think of as being massless in some higher dimension. Yeah, so, all right, I'll say massless theories, right? But I can introduce masses by taking something that's massless in a higher dimension. This you can understand this. Okay, good. So I didn't say necessary, and so you could be wondering why I'm dodging around the word necessary, and that's because I can introduce things that integrate to zero, but that violate cuts. Right, and so I can introduce to a representation. It's a perfectly fine representation of the integrand for an amplitude, right? That when you integrate it, you get the right answer. It is the right answer. It is a scattering amplitude for whatever external momenta you put in, but it violates cuts. But it violates cuts by a total derivative, right? And so it is not necessary to satisfy a spanning set of cuts. It's a different condition. It's that anything that violates a spanning set of cuts has to integrate to zero. That's necessary.
Mm. So, I mean, if I take all the graphs with two cuts, I would have like six cuts. And if I just take those with a single cut, I would only have four. Because you said it would be better to consider the two cut graph instead of the one cut. I mean, according to your recipe, you could still release one further cut condition so that you're left over with a single cut.
Right, so you're saying consider the one particle cut of the tree to itself.
Yeah.
This is a little tricky. It's well defined in certain theories where you can define a forward scattering limit. It's not necessarily a well defined cut for all theories.